many hours a day is it possible to compose and orchestrate?
The answer, once again, is dependent on many factors. The level of craft and knowledge of the composer, the amount of physical energy and mental focus, and the quality of the available time. Your ability to pursue a meaningful career as a composer may well depend on the sum of the above parameters. A developing composer needs to accept that creativity is like a muscle, and the act of creativity involves the vigorous flexing of that muscle for an extent of time. The first time you use that muscle, it may feel fantastic, like the exuberance of an infant whose balance and leg strength suddenly add up to the ability to walk freely. But just like that infant, the realization will eventually dawn that using the muscle is work, and hard work at that. The simple ability to concentrate needs to be developed. What's more, the perception of time itself. Time is a parameter in which an idea may emerge and grow, and how it's spent can often play a huge role in that idea's fermentation. There's a flow to time, a rhythm, and a shape. Working with the form of time takes a while to master, sometimes years. Then, of course, there's the store of practical knowledge. In the first question above, I talked about the knowledge of theoretical concepts as being a huge time saver. It's also an energy saver and a focus saver, in a way. The time one spends in a state of frustration and doubt is anything but productive, and drains enthusiasm away from one's creative arc. What's more, it's physically exhausting. The ultimate meaning of the above stipulations is simple. The ability to devote long hours to composing and orchestrating takes time to develop for most musicians. Demand much from yourself. That's both your right and prerogative as master of your own soul. But don't expect miracles. That's the surest road to disillusionment. Set sensible goals with your time at first, with work sessions in which your focus, commitment, and output are all at optimum levels. Then you'll know exactly what the ideal state of creativity should be. Once those results have merited you with greater creative responsibilities, then increase your time commitment, always being aware of the degree of quality and concentration available. When you feel used up, take a break to recharge and reboot your system. Time away from work is sometimes just as important as time spent at the desk. Eventually, you can expect that the quality of focus, energy, and creativity will become fairly consistent throughout the course of a day's work, with the occasional break. You may find yourself capable of working many hours at a stretch. I often work 10-hour days, sometimes 12, and occasionally 14 or more. Such a schedule can prove grueling at times, but it's common for film composers and orchestrators, and you should know what awaits you in that field. Hey there, this is your orchestration tutor Thomas Goss, with a few more words about creative stamina. One thing I didn't address in my answer to this orchestration question is the quality of the creative task. There are several specific categories of work related to composing, each with their own challenges. The first is the act of conception. This doesn't necessarily have to be divine inspiration. It could just entail following a composition assignment, or dreaming up a proposal for a commission. It could also be the stage in your work where you plan out the form, set the instrumentation, and negotiate with your clients. But it could also be that moment where you suddenly get that idea that opens the door on a new musical work and stirs your creative impulses into action. When you get to a certain point with your craft and creativity, the view through that door can take in more and more landscape. That leads to another category of work, pure creativity. This is when you just compose and compose and compose, letting loose a stream of notes one after the other. Sometimes this is just completely spontaneous, like improvising onto a page of staff paper. Sometimes it's completely deliberate, following a set plan very closely. With me, it's a bit of both in a way, a set of instincts helping me to devise what happens next and how it all fits together. And of course, this needn't be sequential. I've composed things backwards, knowing what the last few bars would be, and then backtracking by steps leading up to that moment. Or I've known what all the different sections in a work would comprise, and then picked off each one in order of deliciousness, like polishing off a box of bonbons. Of course, to balance our inspiration, there are also a couple of categories of perspiration. There's always a stage of editing and rewriting in any thoughtful piece of music, in which the composer may rethink a section or sections. This could be very minor or extensive, depending on a lot of factors: perfectionism, expectations, self-criticism, and creative confidence all play a role, along with your instinctual reaction to what you've composed. Of course, there are also your collaborators, like a director or choreographer, and how their feedback may reshape your work. The other perspiration category is also the last one of all, finalization. This is proofing your score, doing layouts, extracting parts, and any other number of final edits or last changes. How long you spend on this last stage is up to your level of craft at notating. You may also be a composer who feels, like Stravinsky did, that orchestration was simply the act of finalizing a perfected idea. I have a slightly different take on this, sketching, composing, editing, and orchestrating mostly in my head, meaning that when I sit down to notate the work, it's pretty much a done deal. Whatever you do, though, don't make the act of notating a complete score your very first step. What does all this have to do with this video's main topic of creative stamina? Well, each of these compositional stages requires its own level of effort. If you learn to recognize which stages cost you the most effort, then you can learn to balance your tasks for a longer and more efficient workday. That means that any phase which takes the most concentration and effort should be taken on first, or can be portioned out over the course of time. Usually this is the second category, the purely creative stage of work. I know some composers who refuse to answer the phone or check their email until they put in a few hours of work in the morning, and usually this work has to do with composing and developing ideas. Once you've got past this stage, you may want to go into the editing phase, cleaning up some work from a day or two ago. Or you may want to finalize your last project's scores. Once you learn to differentiate these tasks, it's easier to deal with them separately and more accurately estimate what kind of time and effort a project will take. But here's another benefit. You'll be able to tell which stage of creativity needs the most training to bring up to speed with the others. If you can't seem to knock your ideas into shape, then learn more about form and analysis. If the notes aren't quite spinning out with the quality or individuality you expect, do some more score reading of works you've never heard, and maybe polish up your ear training a bit as well. And if your end product looks atrocious, work on your musical penmanship or your notation software skills. One way or another, with all your engines running on full, you can cover far more ground in less time. And with a certain frequency and familiarity of work, your quality is bound to rise, and possibly your level of opportunities as well.